Now, what is Narrow's hernia? It is also called as a prevascular hernia. So, if you ask a surgeon, what he will say? I had a leg pull discussion with my chief in the rounds on this. Narrow's, is it posterior or anterior to femoral vessels? Because we call prevascular, generally we are of a impression that it is anterior to femoral vessels, but it is actually posterior to femoral vessels. So that is the reason I still was talking to one of my Jipmer MS general surgery friend who is a consultant. Still, do you agree it is anterior or posterior? He said that I am running for a case of trauma, so I think after the surgery is over I will tell you. So at the end of the surgery he scrubbed and came out and said, why there are so many questions, people catch on the small things and ask, is it anterior or posterior? But it is called prevascular, it's a misnomer, not found anterior, rather it is found posterior. And Narrow's hernia, the very term is extricated from the surgery books actually. No more people are using the Narrow's and all these pretty names. So that is the reason, doctor, it lies behind femoral vessels, is a true statement. And it is caused by the lateral displacement of psoas is true. It is associated with congenital dislocation is true. But was pectineus was there in the options? Anterior or posterior was there? It is only seen in CDH. Eh? It's difficult to, there are too many pronouns, verbs, adverbs, adjectives and in the belly and love there is a box. Be very sure, our friend has opened the box and found it is given in belly and love. Okay, let us assume he is telling truth. So then only seen in congenital dislocation of hip also becomes a right statement. So I am not sure what was there in the examiner's mind, but anyway I give you a big list which can be the question in the next exam. Now the bro is the most unfavorable presentation that as an obstetrician you like to face. Now the brush burn is an example of a grazed abrasion where there is a friction force which is leading to the lateral rubbing which leads to the development of this kind of a brush burn. So this is how, doctor, if you make the individual scratched on the road, no, then you will have this kind of a somebody dragged with a lateral pressure will develop the brush burns. And what do you mean by patterned abrasion? Patterned abrasion is this kind of ligature mark is a classical example of it. Now how many types of peritonitis do you know? There is one primary spontaneous bacterial peritonitis, secondary bacterial peritonitis and tertiary bacterial peritonitis. Generally secondary is because of rupture of any appendix or anything. Primary, where do you see? Exclusively you see it in cirrhotic patients with ascites with a liver disease. Best treatment for primary peritonitis on any given day is conservative antibiotic management. What will you open inside the liver to do? Secondary bacterial peritonitis, you have a ruptured viscous or anything as the underlying cause. So that is the reason antibiotic management is considered with the management. Third generation cephalosporins are the king among the chemicals in the management of the infection of the primary bacterial peritonitis is what I want to underscore to all of you. The ring of Sommer ring, I think already we discussed, is seen in the case of the after cataract. Then what do you mean by a foldable IOL? There is any unfoldable IOL? Yes, there is. Conventionally for a long period of time to put an intraocular lens, they have used to make an incision. Through that they used to drop the IOL. But when it was an unfoldable IOL, you have to make a 5.5 mm incision, which is little longer. But with a foldable IOL, you can make a 3.2 mm incision, and the new foldable IOLs are all made up of acrylic is what need to be basically remembered. Anderson's Heinz pyloroplasty is done in the case of the pelvic-uterine junction obstruction is what need to be remembered. And what do you do? It is also called as the dismembering type of pyloroplasty, where the pelvic-uterine junction constriction you will be bypassing and then you will be rejoining so that the constriction is overcome and you will be relieving the hydronephrosis. That's what you do in Anderson's Heim's pyloroplasty, which is called the dismembered pyloroplasty, is what need to be remembered. Any penile abnormality is a contraindication for the circumcision, which can be hypospadias, epispadias, cord, the micropenis, which is less than 2.5 centimeters. Any of them can be the important contraindication. Hydronephrosis on any given day, ultrasound is a rapid way to confirm your diagnosis. Was there any question on neurasthenia? I don't have options. At the end of the discussion, let me know that. Then what is the radiation dose of prostatic cancer? This is a good question. Earlier days, before the discovery of IMRT, what do you mean by IMRT, doctor? It is intensity modulated radiotherapy. Before the discovery of that, we used to give around 60-65 grays. But later on with the IMRT, now the dosage is increased to 80 gray, which will give more than 5 years of survival benefit. So 80 gray become the dosage of the prostatic malignancy radiation. Then what is rusburicase? It is typically a drug which is used in hyperuricemic states. It is a recombinant version of urate oxidase. Now I like to ask you a question. Why our goat or a cat or a dog does not suffer gout? And why we humans suffer gout? Because God has given a natural, what buricase? Rusburicase. It is a Latin or a name from Afghanistan. So, rusburicase is there in our cat, dog. So they don't have a need of rheumatologist, indomethacin therapy, allopurinol. They don't go to a chemist and say, today my knees or big toe is paining, doctor, give something. Why? Because they have rusburicase. We don't have. So we have created a recombinant version of this uric oxidase, uricase, which will convert the uric acid to the allantoin. And allantoin is inactive product. It won't cause inflammation like uric acid. It will be lost. So that is how we use the rusburicase. Then jaundice in newborns is generally the physiological jaundice which is found in about 50% of the babies. In deep vein thrombosis, we use enoxaparin, we use intermittent pneumatic compression. Is there any role for aspirin in prophylaxis? There is, but not alone. It should be used along with warfarin, along with heparin, etc., etc. But I don't know, oxygenator is something concept was given. I'm not sure about giving. That means we put the foot of the individual into the oxygen chamber. Compression is intermittent pneumatic compression is accepted. But something is given about oxygenator. It was given? Okay, I'm not sure about oxygenator, but I'm sure about heparin, I'm sure about pneumatic compression and aspirin also, because some studies say yes and no about it, but still we give aspirin as a part of the management. Then let's go to the next question. Minimum alveolar concentration. Some things will cause an increase like hyperthermia, hypercapnia, decreasing age, etc., etc. Whereas increasing age will decrease the MAC, and hyponatremia, hypercapnia, pregnancy also will decrease the MAC. Whereas the sex, weight, duration of anesthesia, mean arterial pressure, none of them will affect the MAC. So you must be very sure about the factors affecting the minimum alveolar concentration. This kind of a lesion is called the lupus perneal, which is a typical feature in the case of the sarcoidosis, is what need to be basically remembered. So where do you see Frohman's test, doctor? When the patient tries to pinch the thumb and index finger, then there is a flexion of the thumb at the interphalangeal joint called the Frohman's, which is seen in the ulnar nerve lesion at the level of the elbow, is what needs to be remembered. Atopic dermatitis, we find on the flexural surface, the scaly plaques is what needs to be remembered. Yes? In an adult or a child, you want to say? Oh, in a child, you mean to say face. But how young is the child? School going, it is once more flexural creases. A newborn or a infant, it is face. Fourth option was? Face. Oh. Good. Anyway, you know the logic child may face, adult may. It will be helpful for AIIMS June. So, but I think that hopefully your point is right. Examiner may have face on the mind. Now, this is a good question, doctor. Every time one question comes on sterilization, without that, we are not sterilized for that year. So, you must be sure on, do we cut two ends, only one end, do we bury, we don't bury. All these things, left and right, you must know. No courtesy on this. So, in Pomeroy's, what we do? We take 1.5 centimeter of segment as a loop. We basically excise it, so that there is no chance the two ends of the loop will reach each other. Then in Maedlerian's technique, what is do? We make a loop, but loop is not excised. So that is the reason still there is a chance that the loop of the tube is only crushed. So still out of that crush, the sperm fellow can jump, leap, and then go and once more carry on fertilization. So failure rate is there. Then you have a Irving's procedure where you will be cutting the medial end, you will bury it into the myometrium. So more of burying is what you do in Irving. Then Croner is ampullary end is basically cut. It is like vegetables, cauliflower kind of a procedure, ampulla. Then finally you have Uchida. In Uchida what you do? You will expose the tube and you will basically separate it from the surrounding tissue and you will be stripping the tubal serosa and you will be basically doing the excision. So all this description falls more in favor of Uchida becomes the answer for this question. So single umbilical artery is associated with the fetal congenital anomalies is a very well known fact. Both primary and secondary lymphedematous states lead to the predisposition to lymphangiosarcoma. Now a child born to the syphilitic mother will not infect the mother. Then whom he will infect? The nurse. Original Colley is a very romantic guy. You know, Abraham Colley's original proposition is a child born to the mother who had no signs of venereal symptoms will present with his, he will present with his disease at the age of a few weeks and he will infect the healthiest nursemaid but not the mother. Was the original description of Abraham Colley's. Must be today he is happy in his graveyard. That fine, the guys are remembering about me, the mother, the nursemaid and the entire triangle of the story. Good. Now what is the cutoff? It has come. Midarm circumference cutoff. What was your answer? 12.5 or 13.5? Actually, answering cutoff questions is like a Solomon's sword on the neck. If I do wrong, I am cut off for this year to join PG counseling session. So don't worry. The point is, greater than 13.5 is the normal value of the midarm circumference. Anything less than 12.5 is considered to be a severely malnourished box in OP guy. So, good. So, I mean, I think entrance is a more boxing show. You must be good with all boxes in all standard textbooks and face the entrance. So, now tell me, doctor, what is the cutoff based on this? 13.5 you want to say? But it is the cutoff for what? Healthy was given, malnourished was given, nothing was given, right? So assume that generally cutoffs are given for a disease, not for a normal. Cutoff can be given for normal also, right? So anyway, we leave it for the cutoff of insanity of examiner. So let's go to the next question.